was buried beneath my shame.
I am counting on the blessings. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. Seniors, if you can come on up, that would be great. Make your way up here. Good morning, though. We are so glad that you guys are here, and it is graduation season. And if you guys could come over here, we're going to line up right over here. Nancy's going to help you. We didn't practice this, so. But yeah, these are a good representation of our students that are graduating. Jonah, you made it. He was at prom last night. I did not think you'd be here. Wow. That's impressive. That's good. That's awesome. But if you get out in the lobby out there, by the way, my name's Jim LaCroix. I'm the youth pastor here. And again, just welcome. Really glad to see so many faces in this building. It's just very encouraging for sure. But back in the lobby there's some bulletins. That's kind of old school, but we have them. And inserted in that is a flyer here, and it's got a picture of all these guys. And I would appreciate it if you guys would take that and pray for these guys as they transition from high school to their next thing. But I'm going to pass the mic. Yeah, you guys didn't know that, did you? But this is all you need to say is your name and what your plans are in the fall. And then if you do know what you're going to study, if you're going on, just to say what you're going to study. So, Ellie, that's a lot of pressure for you, but.
Hi, I'm Ellie Rodak, and I'm going to University of Washington. And I'm not really sure what I'm studying yet, but something in the arts. Yeah.
I'm Grace Johnson, and I'm going to Oklahoma Christian University in the fall to study nursing and ministry.
I'm Melissa Russell, and I'm taking a gap year and then figuring it out from there.
I'm Bethany Johnson, and I'm going to a cosmetology program in this fall. Yep.
I'm Daniel Richardson. I'm going to CSU this fall and studying business.
I'm Abe Richardson, and I'm going to CSU as well and studying agricultural business.
I'm Caleb Ettinger, and I'm just going to stick to running my own lawn care business.
What is it, Caleb?
Caleb Supreme Cut Yard Care.
And snow removal too. Yes, go ahead.
My name is Jonah Bertolino, and I'm going to Colorado School of Mines in the fall to study electrical engineering.
My name is Zach Yakely. I plan to take a gap year and then go to CSU for wildlife biology.
And we, as a church family, really love the opportunity to give you guys a parting gift, and it's the Bible. We feel like there's nothing more valuable that we could give you than God's Word. And it's really a cool Bible, too. It's something called the Filament Bible, where you download an app onto your phone, and you can actually, on any page in the Bible, you can scan this little logo, and it brings up like a Bible study and maps and videos. It's very interactive. It's a very, very cool Bible. We're actually going to have some for sale. You guys get them for free. But if you guys want some, we're going to be selling some in the weeks to come. It's got 25,000 study notes, 350 plus videos, 40 plus maps and infographs. I don't know what that is, but 400 profiles and articles and 1,500 devotionals. So we're just super excited, and we have another super great gift for you guys. That usually I kind of give a little devotional to tell you guys, but I'm actually teaching today to you guys. So that's no charge. You're welcome, all right? But let me pray for you guys, and then we're going to continue worshiping. Father, new life. Again, it's just exciting to see the potential in these students. And I just pray that you would draw them to you, that they would lean on you more than anything else. This next year, I know they're going to have so much coming at them. And I just pray that they would stick to your word, that they would have a deep passion to know your word and a deep passion to honor you in all that they do. I'm just super grateful that you've blessed me to know these guys. Anyhow, I'm just super proud of them, and I'm super grateful to you for them. And I just pray that you would guide them and protect them. Give them your eyes. Give them your heart. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys can be seated down. Oh, yeah, grab a Bible. Grab your gift.
Until I lay my head. your voice. You have led me through the fire, darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Goodness of God.
You may be seated.
Good morning again. I'm still Jim. I forgot my other thing. The graduation service, when we recognize and honor our seniors, is always one of my favorite Sundays of the year. And these students, many of them, we've seen them grow up like right in front of us, right? I don't know. Some of us remember them when they were very little humans. Now they're pretty big, But I just love it. It's so encouraging to me just to see how they've grown, and it's kind of an honor to send them off to their next adventure, whatever that might be. But honestly, this morning makes me a little melancholy too, because I think of some students in the past that we've celebrated, and they've just chosen to go a different direction, not to honor God with their life. And again, I'm praying, and hopefully you guys are praying for a lot of those people too. Yet there's also other kids that I think of as they came up to graduation. I'm like, oh my, this is not a good situation. This kid is going to be in jail. There's going to be something that's going to happen terribly. But then God moves, right, and pursues them. And there's these students that I see that are earnestly seeking God now and trying to honor God with their life to the best of their ability. And I'm like, man, the song Waymaker, it says, man, God, I'm so grateful that you're working even when I can't see it. And again, so that happens too, right? So as I'm thinking about, well, what can I speak about this morning? What can I share from God's word that would really be impactful and memorable and powerful to send these students off. And it's hard to think of something. There's so many things. Seth Richardson said last week that this book, man, it's like a treasure chest, right? There's so much in here to try to choose. Well, what could I choose, like, to encourage our seniors today? And so what I decided to do is I'm actually going to touch on several things I decided not to talk about. And then I'm going to close with what I decided to talk about, all right? But let me pray, and then we'll get into this. Father in heaven, I thank you. Man, I thank you for worship. It's just so great to put this world aside and to enter into your presence and just be with you. I pray now that as we open your word, as we study your word, that you would prepare our hearts and our minds for the reality of your scripture, of your letter to us. Help us to receive it eagerly. Help us actually to want to be transformed and to be changed by your words. So I do pray that you'd prepare our hearts right now for that. And Father, I pray that you would be honored above all else this morning. I pray that in Jesus' name, amen. So as I thought about what I was going to share out of scripture, the first thing I thought of was green eggs and ham, right? Green eggs and ham, that's the first thing that came to mind because, you know, the Dr. Seuss book. And I'm not sure it's taken directly from the Bible. Actually, I'm pretty sure it's not. But if you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, what's taught in there, you know, it could have been the background for this book. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 through 20 says this. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, if anyone has been covered by the blood of Jesus, if anyone has decided to make Jesus Christ the Lord and leader of their life, they are in Christ. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us a job, gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. To be clear, he gave us a very important message that we are to share, the message of reconciliation, the gospel message. So look at verse 20. Therefore, we are ambassadors. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin. He made Jesus to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So there it is, right? Green eggs and ham. You guys see it, right? It's like obvious. Wait, you seniors are like, didn't they teach you this? You guys are confused. I can see it in your face. I don't know what they teach you at high school, but this is the story of green eggs and ham. It's all about Sam I Am. He's the guy bending over right there. It's all about Sam I Am's passionate attempt to convince the narrator of the book to just try green eggs and ham. If you try it, it will change your life forever. And Sam I Am spends most of the book offering the unnamed narrator different locations to have it, different dining guests to share it with, to try this delicacy. And in the end, the narrator relents, and he eats green eggs and ham. And he absolutely loves it. He loves it. Sam I Am is a great and passionate ambassador for green eggs and ham. An ambassador is a representative for or a messenger for. And Sam I Am is one of the most famous ambassadors of all time. The reality is, in our life, We're actually all ambassadors for something or another. The big question is, what are we choosing to be an ambassador for? What are we prioritizing our ambassadorship to be? Seniors, as you move on to your next phase in life, yeah, you're going to be a representative. You're going to be an ambassador of your family and of Salida, maybe Salida High School, potentially Grace Church. But will you prioritize as most important to be an ambassador for Jesus Christ? To be an ambassador for the gospel message. That's what 2 Corinthians chapter 5 is about. But I chose not to talk about that today. We're not going to talk about that. I looked at Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I love this verse. It says, I appeal to you, seniors, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God that are new to us every day, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, meaning your whole life is evidently a living sacrifice and holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Now listen to these words in Scripture. Do not be conformed to this world. Church family, will you repeat after me? Do not be conformed to this world. Man. Do not be seniors, this is going to happen. You're going to be conformed to this world. It's a battle. But you need to recognize it and recognize that Scripture says don't fall into the trap. Don't fall into the trap. But rather, be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Be changed by the renewal of your mind. And specifically what they're talking about is you need to know this book. That is how your mind is transformed. It needs to be saturating your heart and your mind. You need to know what is taught in this book. You need to know the attributes of God. You need to know what passionately makes him happy and what he is passionately against. That is how your mind is transformed. We need to train our minds to be able to hear the Holy Spirit and guide us in life. It's so important. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God. I wanted to speak about discernment today. Oh, I love the word discernment, and we need to understand it. Here's the truth. All of us, seniors, this next year, you're going to have so much stuff coming at you all the time. It's like taking a sip out of a fire hydrant. There's just all this stuff coming at us. And we need to be able to stop and take every thought captive and just think for a moment. How are we going to respond to this stuff? Are we going to respond on purpose in a way that is honoring to God? Or are we going to respond maybe not on purpose, maybe on purpose in a way that is selfish and doesn't honor God at all? Discernment is all about living a life of wisdom in God's eyes. A life of wisdom is a life that honors God with everything that you do. A life of foolishness is not honoring God. It's about selfishness. That by testing, you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect, what is true wisdom. We all want to be wise in the eyes of God, not a fool. But I chose not to teach on that. I'm not going to talk about that. Then I thought about Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 8. I heard an incredible sermon on this 2 weeks ago by George. And it's on our YouTube channel if you guys want. But you should go see it and listen to that. But that first word, trust, we could have a whole message on that. The reality is we do not know how to trust anymore. We tell students, you need to trust in the Lord. And they don't even know what that is because everything that they have put their trust in has failed them. Everything except God. Everything. So we're like, trust, well, I've tried that before and it didn't turn out well. And this tells us to trust in the Lord with all your heart. That means put all your trust there. If you're putting your trust anywhere else, it is going to disappoint you. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. And do not lean on your own understanding. This is kind of a participative message today, but I want to see a raising of hands. If you've said these words this year, or something very similar, God, I don't understand what you're doing. Yeah, multiple times. And when we say, God, I do not understand what you're doing, essentially what we're saying is, I'm leaning on my own understanding and it's leaving me empty. Do not lean on your own understanding. And again, he doesn't give us all the answers that we're looking for all the time. Like, when's COVID going to end? Well, let's see, where's that in here? It's not in here, right? But we know how the story is going to end. We know about God's promises. We know there will be trouble. So yeah, lean not on your own understanding. Lean on the word of God. And it says, in all of your ways, acknowledge him. Again, this is another, a way of saying, you know what? There's going to be a lot of stuff coming at you all the time. You need to be able to stop and acknowledge, what is God trying to teach me in this? How can I actually honor him in all of this stuff that is coming at me? In all of your ways, acknowledge him, and he's going to guide you. If you do that, he will make straight your paths. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Again, be wise in the eyes of the Lord. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. Oh, and then there's a promise. It says, it will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones. After a really hard day, whether it's like physically or spiritually or mentally, I love getting in a hot tub. We don't have one. We're hopefully getting one. But I love that feeling, like, oh, I mean, it just tingles and it's like, oh, it's just like, oh, man, it's just an amazing feeling. And this is kind of, this is so much more than that, because, but it's kind of like that feeling. It's a promise that if you trust in the Lord with all of your heart and do not lean on your own understanding, in all of your ways acknowledge him, he will make straight your path. Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. Then comes the hot tub. It will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones. It's a promise. But I'm not going to talk about that today. Go listen to George's message. One of the stories I love in the Bible the most is the prodigal son. And again, I'm not going to teach on it. I'm going to read through it. This is what it says. It says, and he said, he is Jesus, just to be really clear. And Jesus is teaching here so that we would understand better the heart of God the Father. Okay? So he, again, this is Jesus speaking, a very good source. Okay? The highest source. And Jesus said, there was a man who had two sons. Just stop for a second again. But the man, again, in this story, we have to see, is the father in this story. And this is the representative of God the Father. So if you look at this man's heart, we learn more about God the Father's heart. And then he had two sons, and the two sons are us. Like our typical reaction, our typical heart, our typical sinfulness. The prodigal son gets the headline. He's the rebellious one, and then there's an older son who is kind of the obedient perfectionist. But we'll keep reading this. There was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me my share of property that is coming to me. And the father divided his property between them. So just to stop there, so this son is like us. We're basically saying to God the Father is, you know what? I want to be my own God. You don't actually know what is best for my life. You actually don't know how I can have my best life. So we choose to say, you know what? We're smarter than you. We know better than you. So we're going to live my life the way I want to live it. So that's what this younger son is. They divided the property. Not many days later, The younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And we hear later on that he spent money on prostitutes. He had parties. He just lived it up. And he spent all of his money foolishly. Verse 14 says, "And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the fields to feed pigs." Just to explain, there's like, I don't know if there's much lower of a status in this culture, in this community, than feeding pigs. Because back in that time, if you were around pigs, you were considered unclean. And there was this whole ceremony that you had to go through to become clean once again that took days, sometimes weeks. So this guy had sunk to like one of the lowest jobs available in that culture during that time. And then verse 16, it said, imagine he's in there feeding the pigs. And then he said he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate. And no one gave him anything. So just think about this guy's low point. He's in a pig pen. He squandered everything. And he's feeding the pigs. And he's like, wow, that looks good. I haven't eaten in a long time. And he has no friends to get any help from. Verse 17 is one of my favorite verses in all of Scripture. This version says, "But when he came to himself." There's another version that says, "When he came to his senses." And I think it's really important we stop and understand this moment. But he's in a pig pen, right? And he has this epiphany, this recognition that I've been foolish. I've been an idiot. I've been dishonoring to God. He has that side of the thought, but then he has this second thought about how good his father is. It says, "But when he came to himself," he had this epiphany, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread? But I perish here with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.'" And then this is so important. "Then he arose and he came and he went to his father." So here's the thing that I want us to learn from here. It's important that we all have these moments, these epiphanies of, man, I've been foolish. I haven't made God the God that he is. And then he is good and I should turn to him. So that's like all mental stuff going on, right? But then there's a physical action that happens here where he stands up and he decides to go a different direction. He's doing something different in his life. It's not enough just to recognize it, but you need to change your behavior. And that's what he's doing. And he arose and came to the Father. I'm going to shift gears here because all we've been talking about is this prodigal. Now we're going to talk about God the Father's heart. Because another problem when we have this epiphany of our foolishness and how good God is, we have a hard time actually turning to him because we have the wrong image of what God's heart is like. God the Father, because we think we've been foolish, I'm going to turn to God. He's probably turned his back on me. He's probably going to point his finger at me like, you've been foolish. You've gotten what you deserve. You've been foolish. You need to learn. You know, I think we feel shameful or hurted. And we think that again, God's angry at us. That's not true. Let's look at what the God the Father's heart is like. And he arose and he came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him. So first, recognize his back is not turned on us. I can see this father looking in the distance every day, wanting us to turn to him, wanting us to come back. So I see this father like every day looking, not having his back turned. Where am I? The father saw him, and then he felt, what's the first emotion? He felt angry. No. man, he felt compassion. He had deep love and care for this son that was gone, this son that was rebellious, this son that was foolish. And then this is amazing. The father ran to him and embraced him and kissed him. Man, see the father's heart. And the son said to him, Father, the son's confessing, the son's asking for forgiveness. Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe, put it on him. Put on a ring on his hand. That ring is like the family credit card. So all that he has is his again. All that I have is yours. Put the ring on his hand and the shoes on his feet and bring the fattened calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and found. And they began to celebrate. Now we're going to look at the older son. This older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing, and he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to them, your brother has come. Your father has killed a fattened calf because he received him back safe and sound. But he was angry. The older son was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him, but the older son answered the father, look, these many years I have served you. I've never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes and killed the fattened calf for him. I just want to stop there. I heard an amazing teaching on this a couple years ago, and he was actually this person that was teaching was talking to ministry leaders. And he was talking about, this can be us a lot of the time. Us that go to church, we judge like other people and we don't have a lot of grace for them a lot of the times. And we think that we've earned God's favor by something that we've done. And that's impossible. God just wants us to be with him and to know him and to love him. So, see the father's response to his son. He says, the father says, son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. That's what God wants. He wants us to be with him. He wants us to be to desire to be with him. Yes, we need to be obedient, but perfection doesn't get us a special place in heaven. Being with Jesus is what God desires, to have an authentic relationship with him. Verse 32 says, it's fitting to celebrate and to be glad. For this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. Seniors, I know beyond the shadow of a doubt that you're going to have these epiphanies, these moments where you're just going to recognize you've been foolish. You might be feeling that way today. I don't know. Who knows? I know some days I wake up and I'm like, what did I do yesterday? What did I say yesterday? Did it honor God? We're all going to have these moments where we come to our senses. And my hope and my prayer is that we can remember that all we need to do is turn to him and take one step towards him, and he will run to you and embrace you. And say, welcome home, and all that I have is yours. Man, I just pray that you will remember this scripture, but I'm not going to teach on it today. So what did I actually decide to teach on this morning? Don't worry, it's not a whole sermon. I know some of you are like, oh, great, he's just getting to it. But I want to be overly confident, bordering on cocky, which I know I shouldn't be, on that these verses I'm going to share with you right now are the greatest command to you in all of Scripture. And I know a lot of you are, oh, he just made a challenge there, so is he going to stand up to it? And the reason that I feel so bold about that that is the greatest command that you can ever learn in Scripture. The reason I'm so bold on it, because Jesus said it. I didn't say that. He said this is the most important commandment for you to know in your life. It's from Matthew chapter 22, verses 34 through 40. It says, "But when the Pharisees heard that he, that Jesus, had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. And one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. The question is, 'Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?' And Jesus said to him, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind.'" So he's quoting Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. Again, what is the great commandment? Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the great and first commandment." Another version of the Bible says the foremost commandment. And then he goes on and he says, "And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." And then he says an amazing statement: "On these two commandments depend all of the law and the prophets." We should gasp when we hear that. I didn't hear any gasping. But it's like, sometimes we read by this so fast that we're like, wait, what did he just say? What did he just say? The significance of these words are really, really, really profound. And again, first, consider the source. This is Jesus Christ. I teach to students a lot of time that Jesus is God in a bod. This is God who came to earth to reveal things to us that we deeply want to know. We want to know about God. We want to know about life. We want to know about purpose, right? So this is Jesus, the Son of God. So the source of this information cannot be any higher. That's why I feel comfortable in saying, you know what? This is the most important command in this book, because Jesus said it. And he didn't have to say all that he said. Like, the Pharisee didn't ask for all this information. Jesus went beyond what he was asked and said more, because he wants all of us to understand the importance and the centrality of these two commandments. Like, all that other stuff I read before depends on being able to do these things well. Please see that Jesus has defined clearly for us. He's made it super clear that when you consider all that has been revealed to us in the law and through the prophets, the most important thing is that you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all your mind. Love the Lord your God more than anything else. And it should be obviously more than anything else. And then the second one is to love your neighbor as yourself. But then, again, he doesn't stop there. What he says next, again, should truly stun us. We should be like, wait, I need to go back and read that. What did he just say? He wants us to stop and wonder that these two commandments, it says, on these two commandments depend the whole law, all of the law, and what the prophets taught. So we don't have to wonder, what is the most important thing I could teach today? Jesus made it really clear. But here is the big question, the million-dollar question for each of us, is how can we answer these questions if we evaluate our life honestly? Are we truly living by those two most important commandments? Does our life truly demonstrate that we love the Lord more than anything else? Are we even truly even making an attempt to love our neighbor as deeply as we love ourselves? And to be clear about who our neighbor is, I'm not going to teach on this, really. The Good Samaritan, Jesus talks about who our neighbor is, right? And the reality is, as our neighbor is any person, any human being that's ever been born. God has created him with intrinsic, a great value. Even people we don't like, we are called to love and to cherish and to value. So if we're being super honest with one another, I hope we can say honestly that we all fall short in these two areas. That we struggle to truly love God above all things and completely. And we also struggle to love others as much as we are commanded to do. Here's the good news in that. I think there is good news in that. It is failing. Being frustrated in this should draw us closer to God, to Jesus Christ, to be more dependent upon him to actually accomplish what he has commanded us to do. I personally have given up on trying to love God and to love others out of my own might, out of my own intellect, out of my own wisdom. Instead, I do my best to humbly admit to God every day that I can't do this. Turn my eyes and my heart to you this morning. Help me through your word to direct my heart so I can love you better and I can serve you better and I can honor you better and I can reflect you better. God, lead me in this. Help me to see my foolishness. Help me to see my selfishness. Help me to see my sinfulness. And I pray, God, help me, man, help me to see others the way you see others. Give me your heart, give me your eyes, give me your compassion. Give me your grace, give me your mercy, give me your forgiveness for people, especially the people I don't like. Help me, help me. Seniors, it's you've probably been experiencing this already, but it's like when you're a senior, you have a label on you to get advice from people. Like everyone's giving you advice, right? And what you should do with your life. And this week is going to ramp up because graduation is next weekend. So you're going to be getting all this advice. And I'm not saying to ignore them, hear them out for sure. But know that Jesus Christ, God in a bod, who came to this earth to help us truly understand what eternal success is, he lays it out for us clearly. Above all else, you should love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the great and the first commandment. And he says, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Man, I pray that you would have a desire to study that and to know that and to build your life upon that. Let me pray for us this morning. Father, I thank you so much for this treasure chest of your word. There's so much here that we are actually desperately looking for. And we actually look for the answers that are provided in your Bible and so many other places that just leave us wondering, leave us empty, leave us broken. Man, I do pray that you would help each and every one of us to desire to know your word, to know your heart, to know your promises. We're not going to find those anywhere else but in your word. I do pray for our seniors. I'm so excited to see you work in their lives. I do pray that you would work in a mighty way to draw them to you, and that they would be super excited about where you're going to lead them, super excited about what you're going to teach them. Father, I know that these students, many of them desire to know you, but it's a grind to kind of to be obedient and to be disciplined and to see your fruit all the time. And I know I've talked to students that get frustrated with that. I pray that you would keep them close to you, and in those moments that you would put in their heart this epiphany of how good you are, and that they would come to you and they would seek you and they would find you. I pray as they move on too that you would put people in their life that have a lot of wisdom, that love you deeply, that they could establish friendships that would help them grow to become the people that you want them to be. Father, I'm just grateful for this morning. Now as we stand to sing again, just help us to put all else aside and just consider your greatness and your love for us. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Soul with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Da 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 da. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I'll serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. Yes, I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. With all my strength, I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. Amen. Savior, your name. unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Oh, sing hallelujah, God, above it all. Chain, oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great.
You can be seated for just a second. So last week, Pastor Don announced that he's going to be transitioning out of his ministry here at Grace Church at the end of June. And just a couple of quick announcements. We were having a congregational meeting on June 6th, 2 weeks from today, after the second service. And we'll be getting our search team together, and we'll be kind of telling you the process that we'll be going about to search and to find that position. And as elders and deacons, we've been meeting already and talking. And one of the things we're going to generate is a profile for our next pastor, what we really want in him. And of course, the elders' wisdom, the Bible, all that is going to help us create that profile. But another thing that's going to help us with that profile is we're going to be doing a church assessment, where we're actually going to be doing a survey in the entire church, just to kind of ask you guys a lot of questions, because we want to get some feedback from you guys too. And it'll kind of also tell us kind of some of the health indicators of our church and some things like that. But to be able to do that, and it's totally anonymous, but we do need your emails updated. We need an updated email list, because you'll be emailed a link that you'll go into and then fill out this survey. So there's a computer actually out in the lobby that if you want to check and see what your new, then make sure that we have your email address correct. If you're getting our prayer requests, of course we have your email. But if we don't have your email, if you could call the church or fill that out on that computer back there this week or the next week, that would be very helpful, all right? So let's go and love the Lord your God with all of your heart. Love your neighbor as yourself, and let's go and make much of Jesus Christ our Lord this week. We are dismissed.